You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network, the home of the Options Podcast. For more quality options programs, visit theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app available in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Select programs are also available via live stream at Mixlr.com/options-insider. That's Mixlr.com/options-insider. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at Twitter.com/options, StockTwits.com/options, Facebook.com/TheOptionsInsider, or via questions@TheOptionsInsider.com. You wanted it, you got it. A radio program that helps teach you options trading inside and out, basic to complex. This is Options Bootcamp. Whether you want to learn how to protect your portfolio, generate income, or even become a master of volatility, the Options Bootcamp drill instructors will break it all down for you. Now, let's get you into peak options trading shape. Here are your Options Bootcamp drill instructors.
All right, everybody, that music means it is time once again for Options Bootcamp, the program where we break down the sometimes scary, sometimes just impenetrable world of options for you, the busy retail options trader. Maybe you're just a stock guy. You're looking to dip your toes into those options waters. Maybe you've taken a few dips, didn't like how it went. Maybe you want to improve your next foray into the options waters. Either way, we got you covered. My name is Mark Longo from theoptionsinsider.com, as well as, of course, from this fine network upon which you're listening to this program right now. If you're listening just to this show, I know there's a lot of you coming into bootcamp all the time. Make sure, if you haven't done so already, subscribe, upgrade, if you will, to the full network. You get volatility views, you get option block, you get the options playbook radio. A lot of you people listening to this show will like that one over there, the advisor's option, this week in futures options. A lot of great stuff for you guys to sink your teeth into on this network. And, of course, wherever you listen to this program, make sure you leave a review so other folks can continue to discover this program and send us their great questions like so many of you did today. And joining me to answer all of your many questions out there, he is the black-hatted one himself, Mr. Passarelli, the founder of Market Taker Mentoring and the author of a few, one or two options tomes out there as well. Mr. P, welcome back to the Options Bootcamp Drill Instructor Proving Ground, sir.
Well, it is good to be back. I was just thinking, Mark, do you think it'd be possible for you to get like the Welcome Back Cotter theme music?
We could. It would last a few plays before YouTube and everyone else has to take it down. Already they come at me for all of our theme music every time you post it to YouTube, even though we have licenses for all of it. So I'm not looking to add to my license woes, sir.
All right. We could call up, who is that? There's John Sebastian, I think, who wrote that song.
We call it Welcome Home Cooper. Maybe that we get the knockoff version and we could do that. How about that? Plus, I think for a lot of our demographic of this show, they have no idea what the hell we're talking about. So without further ado, let's keep on rolling right on into the mail call.
Mail call. Time to look at questions submitted by our listeners.
All right, everybody. Welcome to Mail Call. You guys know what time it is. Time for you guys to take the reins. Your questions, your comments, your insights you want to share with us as well as with your fellow listeners. Dan, sometimes you turn the tables on them as well. Ask them questions. We are in unprecedented times right now from an overall market and indeed a volatility perspective, Dan. So at the beginning of this week, we asked our audience here what they thought about the current market conditions. We said, quite frankly, we have a pandemic out there. We have global unrest. We have, of course, elections coming up, a lot that's clouding the future of this market. At the same time, most of the major indices are teetering at or near all-time highs. So let's just look at the major large cap index a lot of you like to look at through the lens of SPY. What are you guys comfortable doing out there right now? Would you be comfortable? We gave you four options. If you have other ones, feel free to write into us. Some of you already have. This just went live not too long before the show. I gave you the bullish option number one, which is just a naked long SPY. Just buying yourself some SPY, set it and forget it. Number two, bullish option number two, going a little bit more limited, going buying calls or maybe call spreads in SPY, so a little bit more vertical. Option three is nothing. I'm in cash. Get the heck out of Dodge. And option four is getting bearish, maybe buying some long puts or indeed some put spreads. So, Mr. Dan, let's start off there. I'm curious, if you have a vote on this one, have at it. And then, B, more importantly, which way do you think our audience is trending in the early stages here, sir?
Oh, let's see here. I'm going to go with, well, I mean, so that's two different questions, isn't it? I mean, I personally like choice two and four best, you know, taking bullish positions as with options, you know, limited risk spreads, preferably, and bearish ones the same way, and just sort of pick my spots. I'm going to say that our audience is with number two. I think they're buying calls and bullish spreads.
Interesting. Close. That is number two. Number one, actually, so far, Dan, is bearish. Long puts or put spreads. Number one with about 44.1%. Followed by number two, bulls, which is calls or call spreads. That's only 23.5%, Dan. And then cash taking the number three spot pretty close, though, 20.6%. And then straight up naked buy and spy, only 11.8%. So clearly no love for buying and holding spy right now. And again, this is early blush. This has only been live for a few hours, listeners. So we'll come back on later shows and see how all this played out. If you guys have your own thoughts on this, head on over at Options on the old Twitter machine. Make your voice heard. Just like a lot of our listeners did today here. Let's start off, as we like to do, Dan, these are troubled times. Let's start off with a little bit of love. Got another 5-star review coming in via iTunes. This one from IRR Guys. I guess he likes his internal rates of return here. He says, great options show with varying opinions on strategies. Easy listens. Well, thank you, IRR Guy. There you go, Dan. So you and I have varying opinions. You say something, then I correct you, and that's how the show goes, right?
That's not true at all, Mark.
All right, let's get on to some other fun ones here. Let's see, Mac. Mac has a question. He says, hey there, Options Bootcamp Drill Instructor Squad. Well, hello, Mac. Loving the show. I've been hitting the archives between the new episodes, and it keeps me going. Glad to hear that. He goes on to write, I especially appreciated the breakdown of early assignment on put spreads from last episode. I had a similar experience, so it definitely benefits you to keep a cool head and understand what is happening in those situations. My question extends beyond put spreads, though. What are your thoughts on how the situation and the risks can change if you are assigned early on a naked or a cash-secured put position? I hope you answer this so I can show my wife I was on your show. Well, there you go, Mac. You're famous, or indeed now infamous. You can prove to your wife you made it on the Options Bootcamp. We had a similar question. A lot of people had questions about what we talked about in our last show there, Dan, about or a couple episodes ago now, which was, of course, getting assigned early on put spreads. Oleander had a similar question here. He says, hey, guys, on the last show you gave an example of what happens to a short put spread when you are assigned early. I understand why your risk doesn't change there, but what if I'm just short puts and I get assigned early? So this is interesting. Dan, we talked about this before. This was obviously the tragic scenario that unfolded with that Robinhood customer. And we gave an example because that's what happened in real life to that customer. From everything we've seen, he was short put spreads, not just naked puts, which makes it all the more tragic. Dan, do you have any thoughts? Then I'll walk through our example again of how the situation changes if you're just naked short the puts, not a spread, and you get assigned early, sir?
Yeah, if you're naked short puts and you get assigned early, good job. That's good news if you're doing it right. I think a lot of, and you know, I'm kind of throwing it out there and putting it so cavalier because I think the intuitive answer is the opposite of that. But I love when getting assigned and acquiring the stock is part of your plan. Like, I love that. I did a whole bunch of that when the market was tanking in March or whatever that was, selling spider puts to refill my IRA up with. You know, shares of the market. Getting assigned is part of your plan. Now, the thing that's, or at least can be, and a lot of times I think should be, the one thing that like is psychologically hard to get over, which we were just talking about psychology in the last show, is that you're always wrong when you do that. You know, you're always wrong in the short term when you do that. Because if you're getting assigned, yeah, there is this kind of sweet spot where you could end up buying the stock at a price that's better than where the market is, you know, when you factor in what you collected on the put. But usually it goes against you and you're down a little bit of money at first. And people just hate that. Oh, geez, this is a losing trade. But if it's part of a long-term investment strategy, I bet you don't care. I bet like you're happy holding on to that, and you might consider writing some calls and generating even more income on that. So personally, I think a lot of times it's great when you get assigned early.
Yeah, we touched on this when we talked about this last time. I believe Eric Metz was on the show with us from Spider Rock Advisors. And empirically, it is indeed you win at that point because, as you've said before, when someone exercises their option, they're effectively getting rid of all that extra time premium that is baked into that option's price, and they're giving it to you effectively for just its intrinsic value. So that alone is a win, and often it's at a strike price that's going to be, in this case, you're selling puts, so it's probably going to be somewhere below the market. So you're probably getting a boon on getting stock a few cents, maybe a few dollars, who knows, below where that stock is trading. So it's a win on that front as well. So empirically, it is definitely a win. The one caveat I would throw out there from a practical perspective out there is that oftentimes this happens and you're going to win and everything we just talked about is correct. A few times this could happen, particularly if you're trading, maybe getting a little bit aggressive with selling some puts in a name. Maybe you don't really follow that well and you're doing it just because a scanner told you there's a high level of volatility in XYZ options and you want to sell those puts and harvest some volatility, harvest some risk premium. You have no real intention, as Dan was saying, of really taking the stock at those levels. And maybe it's a name you don't really follow that well. That's often where these kinds of things can happen. And then it gets a little bit concerning because you don't know what is on the other side of that. Often, sometimes when these types of early exercises come through, it could be someone who sees something, who knows something on the other end, and they see this as they're willing to take that hit of a few cents or a few dollars on that option in order to get in and then get out of that stock at that level before the thing really crashes, or it could be the opposite way on the call side there. So just if you do see these early exercises coming into your account, it does behoove you to go check and see what's going on in that particular underlying. Like Dad said, if you're in this thing for the next 10 years, it's going to be a blip probably anyway. But if something fundamental is happening that you're not aware of in this name, you do want to make yourself aware of it. So that's a relatively small outlier of these cases where these happen, but it could be something happened in the after hours and you missed it, and someone's using this opportunity to get the heck out of the stock at a level that doesn't seem favorable to you compared to where it closed last night, but compared to where it's going to open after the crazy after hours, it could actually be a very favorable level. So just pay attention to that. See what's going on. Maybe there's a reason that they're exercising early, but probably 99% of the time I'm going to go out on the limb and say you're probably looking pretty good in these types of scenarios for all the reasons we outlined there before. All right, let's keep on rolling here. Who's up next on the old hot seat? All right, Richard Brooks. He says, hello. Just wanted to let you know I'm loving Options Bootcamp and listen to every episode on Podbean. Well, you and a lot of others apparently, Richard, because apparently there's a growing Podbean army out there. I wasn't even really that familiar with it until people started hitting us up from that. And I went and checked it out and actually had to go claim our show on there because it was getting a lot of traction on there. And I saw a lot of people are actually out there following that show and a bunch of other ones that we do. So if you like it on Podbean, hey, we love it. We don't judge where you get the show. Like I said many times, you can get it on a donkey cart with a string can in Estonia in the middle of the night. As long as you're listening to the show, you're liking it, you're sending in your feedback, you're leaving your reviews, we're happy. So if you like it on Podbean there, Richards, and all the rest of you who are doing so, have at it. Keep enjoying it. Another comment. This comes from FE346 says, looks like Options Bootcamp is chopping the charts. Congrats. And he sent us this link to this this page here, some top 10 options trading podcast you must follow in 2020. This came out in July. And Options Bootcamp number one, Dan. There you go. So getting a little bit of love out there for your program, sir. It's all you, Mr. P. That's what it is.
Well, thank you so much, THX 1138.
Yeah, exactly. It was George Lucas listening to the show. Amazing out there. Yeah, a lot of our shows are actually up on this list here. Option Block number 2, Volviews number 5, Twifo number 7. So yeah, I forgot what list this is, but there's a lot of them out there, but this particular one seems to like our stuff. So, and thank you there, FE3346. Easy for me to say out there, for sending that in. Bruce, this kind of goes to what we were saying before, Dan, on our last episode. Bruce Linden, he's chiming in. He wants to know, I'm wondering, how long does it take to successfully achieve a level that allows you to make a living trading options full time? This kind of gets to what I was saying before, my caveat at the end of our last episode. I said a controversial one, but an interesting one. Sounds like Bruce is willing to take the plunge here, Dan. He wants to go pro. What do you typically counsel people in that scenario, sir?
I mean, if you can find like a 7-minute YouTube video, you'll be fine, dude. You know, just do that. Just kidding. Just
seven? Kidding. I think 5 is the most you need.
Yeah. No, Bruce, you know what? It's something you can do. We were talking about this on the last episode. I have trained people just like yourself to go pro, or at least make that their only job and make a living off it. And some of them are making a good living off it. But, you know, like, you've got to be willing to put in the time and the effort. Have somebody show you what to do, man. You know, like, there's people who have been there and done this before you. You know, if you plan on doing this 20 years from now, figure it out on your own, I guess, if you want to. But first of all, make sure you're well enough capitalized. Think about how much you can make. And if you're not quite there yet, it might be a little bit more than you're making now. You know, think about how much you can make in a month and be able to withdraw that. And if you can still keep the fund stable or growing, also realize that there's going to be some drawdown periods. It's going to happen. Sometimes it's going to be 2 months in a row where you lose and it's like, oh no, this sucks. So make sure you're more than enough capitalized. And I just feel like a lot of people know when it's time. I feel like the students that I've trained to do this, you know, they didn't ask permission from me to quit their jobs and do it. Like, they knew they were ready, you know? And so if you're not there yet, you can get there. Keep at it, man. You can get there. Keep on keeping on.
And the analogy I use for this is when I became a trader, and you talked about this on the last show as well, Dan, you clerked for a number of years on the floor of the SIBO. When I came in, you know, the typical rotation from becoming a clerk, which was an assistant, a junior trader, moving on up to getting on a badge, as they said, and had a firm actually willing to back you and put capital behind you, that typically was a year and change. That's every day, full time, going down to the exchange, doing whatever work was required down there, hedging positions, getting runs, learning about the mechanics of actually options trading. That was coming back in the afternoon after the close, usually doing some sort of additional training, reading books, reading Natenberg, studying the Greeks. In our case, it was doing a lot of mock trading with each other to see who was the better trader in that scenario, going home, doing more studying, and doing that every day, full time, for well over a year. That's just to really get started doing this kind of thing. So it takes that level of commitment. It's like any other profession. You have to really commit to it to really become a profession. What's the old Malcolm Gladwell? Become an expert is 10,000 hours, right? So you have to put some order of magnitude of work in to really become proficient at this. Like Dan was joking about the YouTube video, but you can't just go on Reddit and go on a YouTube video, maybe listen to a couple of our shows and say, I'm ready to swing for the fences. It takes a little bit more than that. You have to put in the work, put in the time. And then if you are there, like Dan said, if you do feel like you are there and you understand the risks associated with it, you understand the psychological burden you're putting on yourself out there for doing that, then have at it. You know, we welcome people out there who want to dive into that fray and become their own boss and feel like trading is their way that they can do that. But in general, Bruce, you should be prepared to put in at least a few years of studying. Obviously, if you come into us like this, you probably have another day job, so you can't fulfill and can't really devote a full day to it yet. So you have to do it in your after hours or on your lunch break and stuff. So that's going to take a little bit longer. So probably a couple of years before you're probably really willing to even start considering making that leap out there. But if you're willing to do it and if you're interested in it, you're willing to put the time in, I think you can make it happen. All right, Amy Charing chiming in here. She says, folks like Nassim Taleb and others seem to prefer selling ratio put spreads to simply buying puts to hedge long equities against catastrophic meltdowns. Are you in favor of that approach? Is there an optimal construction in terms of months, percent out of the money, and ratio of short to long puts? Thank you for your time. I look forward to this program each week. Great question, Amy. I encourage you to go back into our archives just a few episodes back. We had Russell Rhodes on the program, I believe, in the NASDAQ hot seat, and he and I, and I think Dan was on that episode as well, discussed a variety of flavors of ratio put spreads out there. That was a little bit of a different flavor. That was more of the buying one, selling two type of variety, which is a typical approach and is popular in this environment right now. People want to sell a little bit of premium, but they want a little bit of cushion in their back pocket. Sounds like you're talking the other way, which again is something Tlaib and others do exercise out there. Dan, what are your thoughts on selling ratio put spreads in this environment as a way to kind of carry yourself through the portion of having this catastrophic hedge against your portfolio, sir? And if you like that approach, do you have any sort of optimal construction you like to go?
Yeah, so I mean, I'm reading this. I mean, I read The Black Swan and know a bit about Tlaib, you know, but I don't know exactly what he was trading, you know, which nobody ever does unless you're sitting right there with him. But I imagine what the scenario would be if he indeed does prefer ratio put spreads like this is buying that way far out tail risk put, waiting for the event to happen, and then probably selling a couple that are really, really far out, I guess. I don't know. And I guess that works unless you have like a triple black, like a purple swan or something, right? I mean, I guess if that's what they're doing. Yeah, I mean, it could be good. I mean, the thing with a strategy like just simply going out and buying puts and potentially possibly calls too, like way far out of the money calls or puts to wait for that one big tail risk event to happen. It can be an expensive endeavor for a lot of years, you know, like if you started doing that in 2008 and did that all the way till 2017, you just got bled dry, you know? And it could be, and that can make it psychologically difficult too, you know, back to our last show where it's just, it takes a special person to be able to do that, to, you know, have your plan be to lose for a few years in a row every month and then just hit the lottery one year, you know?
It's a difficult path to take when you're looking at, especially right now, people are concerned, as we just highlighted from our discussion earlier on the show, what people are saying. They're favoring bearish positions out there right now. Markets are extremely elevated. So protection, if you want to go out there and just buy a straight up tail hedge, it's extremely expensive. The SKU index out there at SIBO is about a 141. It tends to top out around a 150. So it's getting up there. And SPY, wherever you like to look, whatever product you're looking at, probably somewhere in the equity indices, I'm guessing, it's going to be extremely expensive. So if you just go out there and just try to buy that now, I mean, it could work out if you have a great meltdown again, like in March, then you'll be okay. But you're paying a ton. And if we just sit here for a little while and keep rallying, you're going to lose a lot of that value very quickly. So folks like Tlaib and others who live for these tail risks, they learned early on you got to do something to finance that. And you're in that scenario again right now where it has to be some other leg that comes in to help finance that. Could be in your case this ratio short put, sell one, buy two or three. So you want to net, the key is to be net long units there. That's what you want. That's if you're worried about this meltdown, you cannot be short units. You can't buy one, sell three, for example. You got to go the other way around. You got to sell one, buy three. So that ends up being a debit, c'est la vie. But at least that's going to make it so you could keep your table stakes, keep anteing up to the table long enough till this big meltdown that you're preparing for actually happens. If you're just going out and buying straight up 5% 1 month or 3 month puts there in the SPY, you're going to go bust pretty quick. That's an expensive thing, and it's not going to work out well until it does, and you have to be at the table when that happens. And if you already blew out 3 months earlier, that's not going to happen. Now, obviously, the downside to what Tlaib is advocating here is that near-term sell-offs, you're going to get hit, and you're going to get hit pretty hard. So understand the risk of that position. Other people like to do other things like selling calls against that, sort of putting on a collar. So now you have your underlying, you have your put, and you're financing some of that with the collar. The nice thing about the ratio put spreads versus the collar, though, is obviously the implied volatility level of the puts is going to be higher. So you're going to get a lot more juice for that, a lot more bang for your buck than just doing the collar. Also, the collar obviously mitigates your upside, which is why you're in this game ostensibly to begin with. So there's a lot of great ways to quote-unquote pay for your puts. And this is one of them. There are many others we've discussed here on this program. I encourage you to go into our archives. Again, if you want to send us exactly what product you're talking about, we can maybe give you more specific recommendations in terms of months and strikes and things like that. These are kind of generic terms you sent us here. But in general, paying for puts is something I've joked about many times that a lot of the industry is devoted to in various ways and shapes and forms. And so I encourage you to look at some of our earlier episodes. We discussed that in a lot of detail. All right, next up, I want to keep on rolling, see how many people we can squeeze into the show here. Dan, next up, San Diego Joe. I wonder where he's from. San Diego Joe says, overall, would you say this pandemic has been good or bad for options traders? Well, I think the caveat goes without saying here, San Diego Joe, that no one wanted anything like this because obviously there are real people dying and real jobs being lost, and no one wanted this. I think the overall umbrella statement is, of course, this pandemic is unquestionably bad. There's nothing good about it from that perspective. If you want to limit it to the myopic perspective of its impact on the options market and indeed volatility, we'll do that for your sake out here. And looking at it just through that very narrow lens, again, we've said it before, volatility is kind of the fuel that drives the options market. And we had a lot of that fuel over the past few months. In fact, the numbers just came in for June and from our friends over there at OCC, and they announced that June was the busiest month in the history of the options market, dating back to 73 there, 693 million contracts changing hands. That's up almost 81% from June of last year. Beat the previous record looks like the previous record was 670 million, so by about 23 million contracts. And that was set back in March. So we've already eclipsed the crazy high levels of volume that we set back in the sell-off in March. Another nugget for you to parse of the top five trading days of all time. Three of them came just last month. The number one trading day of all time is February of this year, February 28th, 48.9 million contracts. Then June 11th, number two, 48 million. Number three, June 5th, 47.5 million. Number four, back to February again, 45.4 million. And number five, June 12th with 43.15 million. So by those objective standards, if you want to say good, as in volume is the overall metric for good, it's kind of hard to argue that this pandemic hasn't at least given a lot of juice into the old marketplace. We talked to a lot of brokers as well who said they're doing record volume. We see the numbers anecdotally here on our network. People are downloading shows like this en masse. So from a lot of those other criteria, yeah, the pandemic has been an interesting development. Dan, what are your thoughts here on the overall impact of the pandemic, good or bad for options traders?
Yeah, I mean, just to call attention, it's really great that you qualified it, like not just to be like legal reasons or to be a wimp or whatever, but like to me, it's an important mindset. You know, like I look back on like a lot of different events, you know, 9/11, where some market makers just, you know, dumb luck, made a bunch of money or lost a bunch of money. And that kind of stuff happens, you know, and you find yourself being a little bit emotionally detached from certain events and being happy you made money. But that doesn't reflect whether you're happy or not happy about the actual event, you know. So, yeah, definitely bad news for the world. But, you know, I mean, it has been reasonably good for option traders, as Mark pointed out, in the volume. And I know a whole bunch of option traders who are just killing it because, you know, volatility is opportunity. And you've got that volatility, and the volatility of volatility is great for option traders, too, where, you know, you get VIX swings and implied volatility swings. So, yeah, I mean, it's overall not a terrible time to be an option trader.
Well, you guys are certainly killing it with your questions as well. Keep them coming. We barely scratched the surface of how many we have here. Many other ones. We'll try to get even more of you on future episodes of the show because we understand it. These are troubling times. People have questions. We're here for you. That's what the Options Boot Camp is all about. So keep those questions coming. You know how to find us on most of the social media accounts. We're just at Options over there. The website, theoptionsinsider.com. A lot of fun stuff for you guys to check out there in between episodes of this show, like our other shows, like great articles, most actives, unusual activity from the options market, all sorts of good stuff there for you guys to sink your teeth into. A lot of great earnings move and earnings move results reports as well for those of you who like to trade options in and around earnings, maybe understand how that works and how the volatility impacts those. A lot of great free data for you over there, courtesy of our friends over there in ORAT's land. So check those out as well over there on the website. And Dan, if they come over to Market Taker these days, what can they find over there, sir?
Oh, man, we're always doing something crazy, man. I think I mentioned a few episodes back that we're redoing the website, and it seems like it's actually not going to take as long as I thought. You know, I kind of figured it'd be months, but it looks like it's kind of moving ahead nicely, and I'm going to be really excited to unveil that. So, you know, especially if you're watching this a couple of weeks from now, definitely come and check out the new website. hit the Contact Us page. Let me know what you think, and it'll be great to hear from you.
There you go. Check them out. MarketTaker.com. Two T's over there. Check out the new site. See what you think. If you don't like it, let him know. He's open to all sorts of your critiques over there. And on behalf of Mr. P and indeed myself, I want to thank all of you out there for downloading, streaming, subscribing, for sending in so many questions and great reviews. Keep them all coming. And we'll see you back here next time for more Options Bootcamp.
You're listening to the Options Insider Radio Network, the home of the Options Podcast. For more quality options programs, visit theoptionsinsider.com or search for Options Insider Radio Network in your podcast provider of choice. Listeners can also access all of our programming through our mobile app available in the iTunes and Google Play stores. Select programs are also available via live stream at Mixlr.com/options-insider. That's Mixlr.com/options-insider. Don't forget to follow along with your favorite programs and submit your own questions for the hosts at Twitter.com/options, StockTwits.com/options, Facebook.com/TheOptionsInsider, or via questions at TheOptionsInsider.com.